Let us pray. Jehovah, we thank you for this morning. We bless your name for this time. As we go into your word, we invite the power of your Holy Spirit to come and speak to us. We thank you because your grace has been there. It has kept us and guided us, O Father Lord. The sufficiency of your grace has been evident in our lives, and we give you glory, praise, and honor. And this morning, O Father Lord, we enthrone the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, I enthrone you, ask, O Father Lord, speak to us, O Father Lord, in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. This is another beautiful time and an opportunity that God gives us to share the Word of God. And today I want us to share on the parable of the wicked vine dressers, or otherwise called the parable of the landowner. And the second parable we want to talk about is the parable of the rich fool. The parable of the wicked vine dressers or the landowner is found in Matthew chapter 21 verse 33 to 45 and Mark chapter 12 verse 1 to 12. I'll read from Matthew chapter 21 verse 33 to 45. Matthew chapter 21 verse 33 to 45 says, "Hear another parable. There was a certain landowner who planted a vineyard and set a hedge around it, dug a wine press in it, and built a tower. And he leased it to vine dressers and went into a far country. Now when vintage time drew near, he sent his servants to the vine dressers and that they might receive its fruit. And the vine dressers took his servants, beat one, killed one, and stoned another. Again he sent other servants, more than the first, and they did likewise to them. Then at last he sent his son to them, saying, 'They will respect my son.' But when the vine dressers saw the son, they said to themselves, 'This is the heir. Come, let us kill him and seize his inheritance.' So they took him and cast him out of the vineyard and killed him. Therefore, when the owner of the vineyard comes, what will he do to those vine dressers? They say to him, 'He will destroy these wicked men miserably and lease his vineyard to other vine dressers, and who will render to him the fruits in their season.' Jesus said to them, 'Have you not heard the scripture? The stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This is marvelous. This was the Lord's doing, and it's marvelous in our eyes. Therefore, I say to you, the kingdom of God will be taken from you and given to one, to a nation hearing, bearing fruit for it. And whoever falls on this stone will be broken, but on whomever the stone falls will grind him to powder. Now the chief priests and the Pharisees had this parable. They perceived that he was speaking about it." The parable of the rich fool is found in Luke chapter 12 from verse 16. Luke chapter 12 from verse 16. Before we read verse 16, I want us to just pick a few verses there. In verse 2, he says, "For there is nothing covered that will not be revealed, nor hidden that will not be known. Therefore, whatever you have spoken in the dark will be heard in the light, and what you have spoken in the inner room will be proclaimed in the housetops." He says, in verse 4, "And I say to you, my friends, do not be afraid of him who kills the body and after that can do no more. But I'll show you whom you should fear. Fear him after he has killed, has power to cast into hell, and I say to you, fear him. He says, are not five parrots sold for 2 copper coins, and not one of them is forgotten before God. But the very hairs of your head are all numbered. Do not fear, therefore, for you are more than many sparrows. He says, whoever confesses me before men, him the Son of Man will confess before angels of God. But he who denies me before men will be denied before the angels of God. And anyone who speaks a word against the Son of Man, it will be forgiven him, but he who blasphemes against the Holy Spirit will not be forgiven. Verse 13 says, then one from the crowd said to him, teacher, tell my brother to divide the inheritance with me. And he said to them, take heed and beware. Verse 14 he says, but he said to him, man who made me a judge and an arbitrator over you. Verse 15 he says, and he said to them, take care and beware of covetousness, for one's life does not consist of the abundance of the things he possesses. Then he said a parable to them, saying, the ground of a certain rich man yielded plentifully. Then he thought within himself, saying, what shall I do, since I have no room to store my crops? And he said, I will do this, I will pull down my barns and build greater, and there I will store my crop and my good. And I will say to my soul, soul, you have many goods laid up for you for many years. Take your ease, eat, drink, and be merry. But God said to him, fool, this night your soul will be required of you. Then whom will be the things that you have provided? So it is with anyone who lays treasures for himself and is not rich towards God. And he says, therefore he said to his disciples, therefore I say to you, do not worry what you will eat. Do not worry about your life, what you will eat, or about your body, what you will put on. Life is more than food, and the body is more than clothing. If we look at these parables, there are certain principles that these parables try to teach us. If you look before the parable of the vine dressers, Jesus gives this parable after he has given the parable of the two sons. These two sons, one consents to authority, submits to authority. Even though by the mouth he says no, the Bible says later he went and did what the father required him. The other one said yes, but did not do what the father required. Jesus was talking about how do we relate with authority. In Mark, when Jesus gives this parable, he is giving this parable after the Pharisees and the chief priests have questioned his authority, and he declines to answer them. They question the source of his authority, and he declines to answer them. Because there is an issue with the authority relationship. In Luke, the parable is given after two stories. One of the parable of the sons. And like you have said, is the same position that is taken in Matthew. So I believe that these parables, these two parables of the rich fool and the parable of the vine dressers, deal with certain important principles in our lives. As we are talking about fruitfulness in our lives, there are certain important principles. It is notable that even before giving the parables of the rich fool. Jesus addresses the issue of accountability. He tells the disciples, be careful of the words that you speak, because nothing that is hidden will be, everything that is hidden will be revealed, even things spoken in secret. He says, be careful about how you treat accountability for your life. He says, your life belongs to God. And therefore, he says, do not worry so much about your clothing, because your life is precious, and that the Lord has authority and ownership over your life. So he goes on to explain this. And it is notable also that there is a young man who approaches this man, who approaches Jesus, and talks to him about the inheritance. He says, tell my brother to give me my inheritance, to share with me my inheritance. And Jesus tells him, who made me a judge over the two of you? Then he talks about, beware the spirit of covetousness. Then he goes on to give this parable. And he says, of the rich man who prepared a ground, and the ground yielded much fruit. The ground yielded much fruit and an abundance of harvest. And this man sits to himself and says, I have much for me. I have much for me. I will tear down my barns. Then I will say to myself, my soul, you have so much stored up for yourself. And there are certain principles that we must understand that come from this parable. There is the issue of stewardship. There is the issue of ownership. There is the issue of accountability. Then the issue of authority. Stewardship is the careful and responsible management of something entrusted to someone's care. It is the responsibility of managing on behalf of somebody else. It is not ownership. It is managing on behalf of the owner. Ownership is the one who has the legal and rightful title to something. We must distinguish these two things. Then there is the accountability. Accountability is the obligation or willingness to accept responsibility and to give account for one's action. Then there is the issue of authority, which is the power to influence or command thought, opinion, or behavior. In these two parables, we see these four issues coming up, these four principles coming up. The Bible says that the vineyard owner or the land owner prepared the land. He built a tower. He planted the vines. He prepared the entire vineyard and prepared the watchmen, a tower for the watchmen. Then he leased this vineyard to the vine dressers. He was the owner. He had the authority. The power to influence what happens in the vineyard was with the owner, who was the land owner. He had the authority, he had the ownership, he had the ability to influence what happens in the vineyard. And he gave the stewardship to the vine dressers. In other versions, he calls them the farmers. He leased the vineyard, a prepared vineyard. It was not an empty vineyard. It was not just a ground. It was something that was well prepared. Every resource that was required for that vineyard had been put in it. And now he was just leaving it to the responsibility and to the stewardship of the vine dressers. And of course, because he gave the stewardship to the vine dressers, it was important that they give account for their stewardship. That's why he sent the agents to go and collect fruit, because he expected fruit. The agreement was that when the fruit is ready, that they will give the fruit. They will give a portion of the fruit that was rightfully belonging to the owner, to the owner. And so the owner sends the agents to collect the fruit. But because the farmers get confused about who the owner is, they decide to kill and stone and cast out the agents of the owner. That means they were casting off authority and saying the owner has no authority. And the Bible says the owner said, at last, let me send my son. Perhaps they will respect my son, for he has authority. He carries my authority. And the Bible says the vine dressers sat down and thought within themselves and said, this man is the heir. Let us kill him, and then the ownership will be transferred to us. And therefore, we will not have to deal with the authority of the owner. And this is the place where Jesus addresses. He says, when this young man comes to him and says, tell my brother to give me what belongs to me, they share the inheritance with me. Jesus does not address the issue of the inheritance. He says, he addresses the issue of covetousness. He says to him, beware of the spirit of covetousness. Because the problem was not the ownership of the inheritance. The problem was that there is a spirit of covetousness that was sitting in this man. And covetousness is a desire to own something that belongs to somebody else. It's a desire to take control of something that you do not have a right or legal ownership to it. And so Jesus tells the disciples, beware of the spirit of covetousness. And then he goes on to give the parable of the rich fool. And he says the land of the person, the rich fool, bore much fruit. And the confusion we get in here is the rich man thought the land belongs to me, the fruit belongs to me. And so he says to himself, what shall I do? I will tear down my barns. I will build others and put my crop in it. And then I will speak to myself and I will say to my soul that you have great wealth stored up for you for a long time. Take it easy, relax, and enjoy your wealth. And the Bible says that God spoke to that man that night and said to him, your soul will be required of you tonight. Then what will happen to that which you have stored for yourself? He's talking about a desire to own that which does not belong to you. A desire, an angry desire, an ambition to own that which is not yours, which you have no legal right to, which you have no authority over, taking it over. And that's what the vine dressers were doing. They were saying, this inheritance belongs to the son. Let us kill him and then take authority over it. This is where we get problems. And this is where the vine dressers get into problems. They do not understand that the farmer has given them the vine, the vineyard. He has taken care of everything. He has prepared everything. And all they have to do is to harvest and to take care of it and to give account. As human beings, as men created by God, there are many times we get confused about who owns what in our lives. And therefore, we get confused about our responsibility for our lives. Too many times we are too busy trying to cast off the authority of God. Like these vine dressers who are busy trying to cast off the authority of God, of the landowner. Psalms chapter 2 verse 1 says, it says, why do the nations rage and the peoples plot a vain thing? The kings of the earth set themselves, and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and against his anointed, saying, let us break their bones in pieces and cast away their cords from us. He who sits in heaven shall laugh, the Lord should hold them in derision. For he shall speak to them in his wrath and distress them in their deep displeasure. Yet I have set my king on my holy hill in Zion. The psalmist talks about the nations plotting and agreeing and saying, let us cast off the authority of God. They say, let us cast off the authority of the anointed one. And the Bible says the Lord laughs at them because they do not realize that what they have is something committed to them and they must give account for that, and that there will be judgment. The Bible says the Lord laughs at them. The Lord laughed at the rich fool. He said to him, you are planning great things for yourself, but tonight your soul will be required of you. Then what will happen to that which you think you have planned for yourself? Who will own it? Because it is not for you. It does not belong to you. It belongs to another that you must give account to. It does not belong to you. The vine dressers didn't realize. They attempted to forget that the vineyard did not belong to them. It belonged to the landowner. And they tried to cast off that authority. If we read in Genesis chapter 11, Genesis chapter 11 tells us of the situation in which many of us find ourselves in today. After the judgment of the flood, the man, knowing the history of what had happened, said in verse 3, they said to one another, come, let us make bricks and bake them thoroughly. They had bricks for stone and they had asphalt for mortar. And they said, come, let us build ourselves a city. And the tower whose top is in the heaven, let us make a name for ourselves, lest we be scattered abroad over the face of the earth. And the Bible says that the Lord came down and confused their language, and they were scattered and they stopped building. Men throughout the years have recognized the fact that there is a God in heaven, that there is a supreme authority in heaven who holds sway and power over everything on the earth. That's why the Psalm says that the earth is the Lord and everything in it, that there is an authority. In Romans chapter 1, Paul talks about this situation in the hearts of men. From verse 16, he says, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God for the salvation of everyone who believes. For the Jew first, for the Jew, and then for the Greek. He says, for the righteousness, in it the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith, and is as it is written, the just shall live by faith. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who suppress the truth in unrighteousness. Because what may be known of God is manifest in them, for God has shown it to them. For since the creation of the world, his invisible attributes are clearly seen, being understood by the things which are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. Because although they knew God, they did not glorify him as God, nor were they thankful, but became futile in their thoughts, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Professing to be wise, they became fools, and changed the glory of the incorruptible God into the image made like the corruptible man, and the birds, and the four-footed animals, and creeping things. Therefore God gave them up to uncleanliness. Paul writes and says, the attributes of God are visible to man. Even without reading the scripture, even without reading the Bible, even without hearing the gospel, the attributes of God are visible to man. That we can see it from creation. It is visible. There is an intelligent creation design that has happened. That nothing happens without a purpose. Nothing happens without the design and the existence of God. And he says this is visible to men. But he says when men profess to be wise, they become fools. And the Bible says in Psalms chapter 53 verse 1 that the fool says in his heart, there is no God. There is an attempt to disconnect ourselves from every relationship with the authority and the power of God. Like the vine dressers were killing the servants and the agents of their own landowner to disconnect themselves from their level of accountability that would be required of them. And man has attempted to seek to walk away from accountability, has attempted to walk away from giving account. Man has come up with the principles of humanism, which say there is no God, that you can just do what is good and forget about God. And the Bible says the fool says in his heart there is no God. We are trying to sever our relationship with God. We are trying to sever our relationship with the landowner. We are trying to sever our relationship with the one who has planted for us a vineyard, who has planted in us a vineyard. God who has planted in us our knowledge, skills, abilities, and our intelligences, our talents, our giftings. God who has prepared these things for us. He has prepared and he expects fruit in us. He has prepared this as a vineyard and he has leased it to us. He has given it to us. He has lent our lives to us. Prepared these things for us that we may give him fruit. The Bible says, Jesus, when he was speaking to the disciples, says, I called you that you may bear fruit and fruit that will last. This week I was reading an article and someone was saying that the trees that bear fruit, they don't bear fruit to themselves. A mango tree does not eat its mangoes. A maize plant cannot consume the fruit it produces. It produces fruit for the owner. And Jesus says that I have called you that you may bear fruit for the owner. The landowners were supposed to bear fruit for the owner, so that when the agents come, they can collect the fruit for the owner. And our lives belong to somebody else. We are not of our own. We belong to God. And the landowner gave, leased this land to the vine dressers as God has given us our lives. And the Bible says even the lives that we live after salvation, that we were purchased at a price that is heavy, the blood of Jesus. We do not belong to ourselves. And Paul writes and says, it's no longer I that lives, but Christ who lives in me, for I belong to God. And that's what this parable is about, that we must understand that our lives belong to God, that God has leased our lives to us. He has leased the gifts to us. The Bible says that the rich fool reaped a harvest. But we know from the parable of the growing seed that Jesus says that the person went and planted seed, then he slept and nature took its course. It is God who provided the rain. It is God who made the soil of the soil fertile. It is God who protected the seed so that it was not eaten by the birds. It is God who took care of everything. And finally, when the yield was there, this man confused and saying, I have something for myself. I will prepare bigger barns. I will keep my crops in it. I will tell my soul, rest and have peace. Take it easy. You have good stored for many days. And God comes and tells him, my friend, tonight your soul will be required of you. Then whose will be that which you have prepared for yourself? Because it isn't about you. The fruit you bear is not about you. When we talk about being fruitful, it's not about us. It's about bearing fruit for God. And fruit that lasts. We get confused about who the owner is. We get confused about our responsibility. We have a responsibility to be stewards of what God has given us. Because he is the owner. He is the land owner. He is the one who makes our land produce yield. The Bible says it's God who gives us the ability to make wealth. It is him who makes us profitable. He has put agents around us who come and require the fruit. We have families who come and require the fruit. The Bible says that we must be people who are able to take care of our families. Because our families are agents of God. These are the servants God sends. And he says, go and require the fruit and accountability from the vine dressers. We have children who we have to give account for. Because they are the agents that God has put in our lives to bear, to receive fruit from our lives, from our gifts. We have employers who we work with. They are just agents to receive the fruit that God has planted and brought out in our lives. We have ministries in our churches. Sometimes we get confused and we think this is about us. It isn't about us. It's about God. And God sends men to us. God sends women to us. And he has given us the gifts of the Holy Spirit. And he expects fruit from our lives. That's why he says, Jesus speaks and says that you will know them by their fruit, because those fruits will give account. And he says we must give account. He says on earth, when you are required to give account, don't worry. Let what God has planted in you be the one that gives account. He says if you are ashamed of what God is doing in your life, then he will be ashamed. Because every time you are required to give an account of the things that God has entrusted to you. This life that you have. Paul writes somewhere and says, do not be afraid. Be ready to give an account of the reason that you believe. There will be accountability. Because we are stewards. Entrusted the things of God into our lives. We must give account to the one who holds authority over our lives. It is important that we learn these principles, because the authority does not belong to us. Paul writes and says, how do we relate with authority? How do we relate with the authority that's put on us? And the Pharisees come to Jesus and question him on this matter. And he says, shall we give the taxes? And Jesus says, give to Caesar what belongs to Caesar, and to God what belongs to God. And so he's saying, in the physical realm, you have to deal with authority. You have to remember that the authority that has been put in place, like Paul says in Romans, that authority has been put in place that men may live in peace. And he writes to Timothy and he says to him, pray for the men in authority, because God has put them there, that men may live in peace and that they may come to the knowledge of God. God has instigated authority, and we have to relate with that authority properly. That's why when Jesus gives this parable, he's dealing also with the issue. He's talking about these two sons, one who related with authority by lip service and the other one who related with authority by action. And Jesus talks in Isaiah and he says, these men honor me with their lips. Because we need to have an understanding that God has put us in this place, on this earth. We must be accountable. We are stewards, like the vine dressers. We are stewards, and the owner, who is God, will demand fruit from us. We must give account. We do not have an option of not being fruitful. Like we read in the parable of the talents, the option of not being fruitful is not there. We have only one option, bear fruit, because the vine dresser, the vineyard owner has prepared. There is no excuse. The vineyard owner has prepared. God has poured rain on our land. It is bearing fruit. We must give fruit. But this fruit belongs to God. Let us not be confused about these things. We are stewards. We must give account. The owner is God, and we have to give account to him because he has the authority. This is what these two parables are about. Paul writes and says, these men professing to be wise. There are people who profess to be wise. Men have grown in intelligence, Now we are having what is called artificial intelligence. We have made computers. We are using DNA to multiply men, to attempt to multiply men. We are using other things in an attempt to create. We are trying to overtake God. And many of us have found alternative explanations as to the reasons why we exist and why life is. He says, professing to be wise, they became fools. And therefore, God gave them up. Interestingly, the Bible says God gave them up. There will be a time for judgment. There will be a time for judgment. We must be able to give account. Our lives belong to God. These two parables, if we forget everything else, let us remember, our lives are not our own. They belong to God. It is a gift that God has given us, and He expects us to bear fruit. Our talents are not our own. They belong to God. They must bear fruit for God. Our knowledge, our skills, our abilities belong to God. God has put us on earthly relationships. We must remember, He is the owner. Whether it's a marriage, the Bible says children are a gift from God. Our job is as stewards to raise them up in a good way. So that at the time, as the time comes, when God comes to collect the harvest, they will be ripe and ready for Him. Our families are something that God has entrusted to us. Our work is something that God has entrusted to us. Our ministry is something that God has entrusted to us. We are stewards. We must give account, and we must bear fruit. For the owner who has authority, the Bible says, when Jesus was speaking, He said to the disciples, do not be afraid of one who will destroy the body and after that do nothing. But be afraid of one who has authority after destroying the body will be able to cast you into hell. So He says, remember the one who holds the ultimate authority. Don't get confused. There is authority on earth. There is physical authority. But He's saying at the end of the day, remember that after giving account or living and relating whichever way you have related to the earthly authority, your fear and your respect for authority to the earthly authority should be below the authority and the relationship you have with God. If you have not given your life to Christ, if you have done everything you have done to attempt to cut off the relationship with God, it will not dissolve the responsibility you have to give account to God. These vine dressers skilled up to the sun, and they thought that because you have done that, that will eliminate our responsibility to give to the vine dressers. It will never. The authority will still be there. Whether you believe or not, whether you accept that there is God or not, the reality is that you will give account. Sometimes I tell people, it is better to risk to believe that God is there and find out that He's not, than to risk to believe that He's not there and find out that He's there. Because when you find out that He's there, after you have gone from the earth, there will be no turning back. If you believe or you don't believe, doesn't make God exist. God is there. God is real. Whether you believe or not, He sent His Son to die on the cross. Whether you believe it or not, whether you acknowledge Him or not, He is coming back. And He will require an account of you. Let us pray. Jehovah, we thank You and we bless You. We give You glory for this word. We pray, God, in the name of Jesus Christ. Father, Lord, let this word continue transforming our lives and changing our attitudes and shaping us, O God, into the image and likeness of You, as You have designed and desired of us originally. that God may fulfill the purposes that you have sent us on earth and bear fruit for you in this season of fruitfulness. We thank you and we bless you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you.